Good morning and welcome to all of you in here and all of you in the cyber world. Announcement that on January 30th, we will have a congregational meeting after a unity service. So worship will be at 10 and the congregational meeting will be at immediately following the worship. There's a bunch of stuff we have to do during that meeting. We have to elect a nominating committee, have the meeting of the corporation as required by Tennessee law, receive the budget, and approve the terms of call for me. Even with all that stuff on the agenda, it'll probably only take a few minutes, but we have to do that. And finally, Barbara needs help getting the stuff we collected for the Afghan families settling in our area. She needs help loading, driving, unloading. So if you can help with that, please give her a holler and she will arrange a time with you. So let us begin our worship. The Lord be with you.
Awesome.
Today we're going to remember Christ's baptism and our own baptisms, and we will consider why that matters and what we might do about it. Let's worship.
Please join me in the call to worship. Today we celebrate a special baptism, the baptism of Jesus of Nazareth. God says, "Look, see my chosen servant, the one in whom I delight. Place my spirit on him. He will bring justice to the nations." When Jesus was baptized, the heavens opened up and the spirit came down like a dove. And there was a voice from heaven saying, "This is my dearly beloved son with whom I'm delighted." The joy of the Lord be with you all and also with you. Most wonderful God, though we are often foolish and frequently flawed, we too delight in your beloved Son. As in his name we gather as your church, may the heavens be open for us that we may catch a glimpse of that light and love that transforms our common days with a beauty not of our making, and hear your voice declaring us to be your beloved children. Through Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.
God be the love we search and keep me. God be the prayer to move my voice. God be the strength of now upon me. Love Christ around me.
We belong to God. Nothing can break this covenant. Let us then with confidence approach God to honestly confess our sins in prayer. God, you call us to love community with you and
with each other.
But we exclude and reject those who deem different.
You claim us as beloved.
But we turn against each other in anger and hate. You liberate us and lead us in Christ's path of peace. That we build walls and invest in guns and dismiss peace as impractical and unrealistic. Redeeming God, forgive our warring ways. Call us and claim us once again for the work of building your beloved community. Amen. Do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. We are redeemed. We are made new. Amen. Help us, Holy God, to connect to your word in new ways today. Open the scriptures to us in ways that are life-giving. Encourage us to listen to the message your spirit makes known to us in word and worship. Amen. First scripture reading comes from Genesis 1, 1 through 5. When God began to create the heavens and the earth was without shape or form. It was dark over the deep sea. And God's wind swept over the waters. God said, "Let there be light." And so light appeared. God saw how good the light was. God separated the light from the darkness. God named the light day and the darkness night.
Okay. I saw Bethany stand up and I was like, oh, what are we doing? All right, I want to talk to all the kids. Dear, dear children. So there are, okay, so you know the Bible. The Bible is a big book made up of littler books. There are 66 books in the whole Bible. There are four books that tell the story of Jesus's life. And those are called the Gospels. And they are Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Each one of them begins very, very differently because for each one of them, they wanted to tell the story of Jesus in a certain way. So Matthew starts out with this long, long list of all the generations before Jesus. And then there's a little bit of the Christmas story, and Matthew kind of focuses on the wise men and all that. Then you have Mark. That's what we're going to look at today. Mark doesn't even mess around with any of the children part of Jesus, no birth story. He just dives in, John the Baptist, Jesus is baptized, off we go. John begins in a kind of a, what might sound weird, he begins with things like, in the beginning was the Word. And I think if you were listening to our scripture that Mr. Rick just read, I think you'll notice that that is how it's similar to the way the very beginning of the Bible starts. So John wanted us to start out with, just some understanding how big Jesus' story is, that it's as big as the universe. And then we go back to Luke, and Luke is all about how John the Baptist got born and how Jesus came to be, and about Mary and Elizabeth, and then the birth story that we hear at Christmas time. Today, we're going to talk about Mark. And Mark tells us his way of starting the story, a little bit about John the Baptist, and as I said, then Jesus's baptism. And in Mark's story, the Holy Spirit comes down, and God says about Jesus, "You are my son, whom I love. I find happiness in you." And that's how we can think about our baptisms too. That is a time when we say, yep, I am claimed and loved by God. So let's pray. And then I think Tatiana has sent you some things, which is awesome, to do for children's worship. So let's say a prayer and you say the words after me. Dear God, thank you for your stories. Thank you for four different gospels. Help us to hear. Help us to soak them up. And help us to love you more. Amen.
For the next several weeks, you guys are going to be hearing this song quite a bit. So we decided to do it in anthem form today. We will be beginning and ending our worship with this song based on our series that we're in right now. For sake of life, the face of truth will brighten. For sake of life, the seat of hope will rue. For sake of life, the way of peace will lighten. For those who dare to walk, for sake of life. For sake of life, the fields are being seeded. For sake of life, there's still growth in the earth. For sake of life, we'll share with all that need it, the bread from common soil. For sake of life. For sake of light, a righteous wrath needs power. For sake of light, let streams of justice roam. For sake of light, the springs of joy will mother. The newborn child of hope, for sake of light. For sake of life, our God became an infant. For sake of life, he lived and died for all. For sake of life, the time of God was constant. The
Thank you, Bethany and Forrest. Let me get this off. I was going to ask Bethany to sing it again in the Swedish because we have the Swedish words.
Whited that out.
Oh, she whited that out just to save herself from the possibility, I guess. Pray with me. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. From Mark chapter 1, verses 4 through 11. John the Baptist was in the wilderness calling for people to be baptized to show that they were changing their hearts and lives and wanted God to forgive their sins. Everyone in Judea and all the people of Jerusalem went out to the Jordan River and were being baptized by John as they confessed their sins. John wore clothes made of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist. He ate locusts and wild honey. He announced, "One stronger than I am is coming after me. I'm not even worthy to bend over and loosen the strap of his sandals. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." About that time, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee, and John baptized him in the Jordan River. While he was coming up out of the water, John saw heaven splitting open and the Spirit like a dove coming down on him. And there was a voice from heaven, "You are my son, whom I dearly love. In you I find happiness." This is the word of the Lord. So in the church calendar, today is Baptism of Our Lord Sunday. Each year, starting in Advent, we retell the story of Jesus's birth, his life, his death, his resurrection. And we rotate a bit between the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And as I mentioned with the kids, each Gospel takes a different approach to telling the story of Jesus. And Mark, it's the earliest of the four Gospels, is the hurried telling. There's no Christmas story in Mark. We just dive in with John baptizing, we get Jesus baptized, and we are off to the races. Today, I want to look closely at how Mark describes Jesus' baptism. I want to talk about why it matters, and finally look at what we might do about it. Mark's Gospel is a galloping account. The word "immediately" is used over and over again, and it gives the whole thing a sense of urgency. It's as if Mark is so excited to get the story told, he just has John arrive with ta-da and starts baptizing. Now, we tend to think of baptism as fairly serious, as a formal thing. It is an important thing. It is a sacred thing. But what if it's actually a joyful party? What if we treated it like an occasion for laughter and holy play, for celebrations worthy of shenanigans and fun? Maybe something like this movie clip from Godspell I want you to watch as it introduces John the Baptist.
Thank you.
Look at verse 5, where it says, everyone in Judea and all the people of Jerusalem went out to the Jordan River and were being baptized by John as they confessed their sins. What if that was full of joy, spilling out as people were able to see themselves as sinners set free and beloved by God? It makes sense to me that there was more joy than Mark's fast telling, his sparse account, can convey. If so, it's no wonder that people were coming from all over the place to get in on John's baptism. For Mark's telling of the Jesus story, no sooner than we hear about John doing his baptizing thing, we're galloping off into the story of how Jesus was baptized. There's no educational summary, no cute anecdote from John's college years, just poof, there's John, here's what he did, skip to the good stuff, and now here's Jesus coming out of the water being dived bombed by the Holy Spirit with the voice of God ringing from the heavens. In Jesus' baptism, the barrier between earth and heaven, between the sacred and the not, I can't think of the word at the moment, but the unsacred, that barrier was cracked and God showed up. God made God's claim on love for and delight and joy in Jesus. God made those very, very clear. Now, with that kind of beginning, we can't help but be on the edge of our seats waiting to see what happens next. When our daughter was small, she would ask us about things, so what? And it sounded at first like she was being dismissive or disrespectful, but she was really saying, so why is this important? Why does this matter? And that's our next question to ask of this passage. So what? Why does it matter? Is it just biography and an interesting story, or is there something more for us here? Well, I'm so glad you asked. One reason it matters, just as Jesus's true identity is revealed at his baptism, our true identities are revealed in our own baptisms. Imagine with me, a long line of people waiting to be baptized from John's baptism of Jesus going on until now, including us. What do we all have in common, those of us standing in line? We long to be set free. We long to be truly seen, truly loved. We long to know that we can repent in the sense of changing directions. We long to be known that we can be welcomed to the party with joy. We long, like Jesus, to be claimed by God with that love. And here's the good news. The same message that was spoken over Jesus is also for all of us spoken that are standing in line behind him. Baptism is what tells us we are loved by, we belong to, and we are claimed by God. Now the world will happily tell us over and over again, we are insufficient, that we're not enough and never will be enough. And then the world will sell us a product to help give us the illusion of being enough briefly until it's time to sell us another product. But in our baptisms, God says, you, as you are enough and more. And when I spend time with you, it brings me joy. There's a poem by Jan Richardson. It speaks of the power of knowing that you are beloved and the struggle to hang on to that knowing in the face of all the not enoughness that the world hands out. Her suggestion is that we say to ourselves and to one another over and over again, beloved, until it is how we see ourselves and see one another. Our passage ends with a splitting sky, the dove, the voice of God. But Jesus' story doesn't end there. Neither do our stories of being claimed and loved and delighted in by God. To be baptized is to step into and claim that love as the guiding force in our lives. And that love, in turn, will compel us to see the places where that love is in short supply. That love will move us toward all the people who desperately long to be seen and claimed and loved. And those people truly are all around us. Every Wednesday, at the end of chapel with the childcare kids, I say each child's name, looking right into their eyes, and say, God loves you. And I will tell them sometimes, and I'll say at the very end, I'm going to tell you the most important thing, and that is that God loves you. They sit perfectly still, waiting for their turn to hear those words. And every week, the ones waiting look a little anxious. Like maybe I won't say it to them this time. And most of them break out into grins when I say that. This week, in the two-year-olds class, as I was going down the line, and they were busting out in grins at the very end, I said, Wilson, God loves you. And he said, thank you. It was kind of one of the cutest things I've ever seen. But to be named and claimed and loved and celebrated by God is also to be sent by God. We are sent in part to invite others to join us in knowing that we are beloved. Which leads us to our final question for this text. What do we do with it? Well, the first thing we do is we soak it up and let it get deep within ourselves. Repeat after me. I am a beloved child of God. With me, God finds joy. Who around you longs to hear such a thing? Who is longing to be seen and invited in to belong? How do we take who and what we are because of our baptisms and use that as a place from which to share hope and love? How do we invite people to join the party? How many ways are there to tell the people around us they are beloved? Now, here in the South, in the Bible Belt, bringing up anything to do with religion is tricky, to say the least. But loving people, finding ways to share hope with them, praying for them, even if you never tell them you're praying for them, encouraging them, sharing words of affirmation with them, all of that can be done without ever mentioning religion. Maybe we could find ways to say to one another, you're my friend, whom I love, and when I'm with you, I feel happy. Or maybe, you are my daughter, I love you, and I'm proud of you. Spending time with you is such a joy. We're called to help people see themselves as beloved. Second thing, when we see groups being treated as unloved or unlovable, maybe they're mistreated because of structural poverty or institutional racism, are we not called to remind those in power that people who are being hurt by things like racism and poverty and misogyny are also beloved people and should be treated as such? I think we are called to do that. What about this? Here's a challenge for you. What if every time we're around water, washing hands, bathing, doing dishes or laundry, every time we're near a river or ocean, and if any of you are close, you can probably hear the rain on your roof like we can hear it in the sanctuary. What if every time we're around water, we just took a moment to let it remind us of our baptisms, that we are named and claimed and loved and enjoyed by God? What if we thought about that baptism scene from God's bill? And what if we then looked around for a way to remind someone else they too are named, claimed, loved, and enjoyed by God? What if we looked around for a way to invite them to this party? And as much as we're all washing with COVID, washing our hands with COVID, sorry, that would be a lot of reminding. But what might happen if we thought more about our baptism and what it meant about who we are? What wonderful things might we set in motion? What power might we unleash? We talked about what happens in this passage. Jesus gets named, claimed, loved, and enjoyed by God in his baptism. We watched a short video clip that gives us a vision of how baptism can be a raucous, joyful party. We talked about why it matters, because we who come behind Jesus are also named and claimed and loved and enjoyed by God. And that is transforming for us and for the world around us. And then we talked about what to do with all that, to do our darndest to convey that love outward in as many ways as we can and on as many levels as we can, to invite others to come get in line for the party. Amen.